dance company has, we always do an arts integration program that goes along with the dance. So we bring it into the schools because I do a lot of research before I present and before I teach. I believe heavily in arts integration. So I'll go back to that in a minute. So then I was like, okay, well, I need to have some input from teachers, and I believe in so much of what we were doing in the process of Da Vinci's books and how I did the process, that I wanted to share it because we found that audiences wanted to know more, and I wanted them to know more. And then also, I wanted to hear how this process that is, you know, Da Vinci used is relevant for today. And so then I brought my experts in. Sean Cocco, who is a professor at Trinity College, he was one of the first people that I actually spent a lot of time talking to, and he opened up the world to me more of Da Vinci, and took it out of the book and made it real and put it in context. So he's gonna present first. Then I will show you little snippets of the dance, because I think it's very important that you see what I did and how it's translated into motion and movement and why that's important. Then we are following that with our fabulous panelists and moderator. So Kion Wolf, who I have been hearing about for ages and following and never got to meet in person till now. So I'm super, super excited. And then we have Amy Lomenzo, who is an artist in her own right. She spent 23 years in Italy and introduced me to Da Vinci's notebooks. When she heard I was doing the dance, she's like, oh, well, you gotta look at these. Oh, okay. So they're like my Bible now. Caitlin Kennelly, is that how I pronounce it? Kennelly. She's a colleague of mine at the Greater Hartford Academy of the Arts, and I've wanted to collaborate with her forever and a day, but it's always hard to find the funding to do that. So she and I have talked at length and on different projects. And then Rachel McAnallin is a mathematician, and come to find out, I grew up in Vermont, and my mom is a teacher there, was a teacher there, now she teaches adult ed. She took a workshop of Rachel's many years ago in the town next door. So it's just wild. Did I get everybody? I got everybody. So we are taping this so that we can use it both to take, you know, on tour when Da Vinci, the Dance of Da Vinci goes on tour, but also to be able to capture the information as we continue developing the work. So I am now going to hand it over to Sean, and he has to hold a mic, which he didn't.
Thank you. I'll see if I can pull that.
Okay. I'm
used to sort of waving my arms around and gesticulating a lot, so I have to sort of lock this arm into place and try to hold still. Thank you for coming tonight. So I think the substance of my comments are really ordered around reflections that have come out of my conversations with Sonia and my observations of some of the process of her developing the dance and then seeing the performance last year. So if there are kind of biographical questions about Leonardo's life, and that's often how Leonardo's approach is a kind of genius outside of his time, maybe we might return to those. But really what I'd like to reflect on, not so much as a sort of biographical sketch, but a set of reflections on how I see his work reflected in what Sonia is doing. I thought I would begin with, this is what you can do often with Leonardo's visual cultures. You can pick any single one of his images in some ways and see in it compressed a visual argument about deeper truths that Leonardo had discerned and understood. I find this as a very fitting kind of winter image. It's one of his sketches of his understanding. It's quite clear that he had understood the principles of area preservation in the branching of trees. And so what Leonardo was demonstrating in this picture, as you can see perhaps in the lower image of the tree, it's a nice winter image. In fact, now every time I've been driving around, I've been looking at trees and thinking and sort of recognizing the principle that Leonardo had observed was essentially the notion that you can see him working out, that you could take in a section out of any of that kind of hierarchical branching network the sum of the areas would be equal across the different sections. And so it's Leonardo's demonstration that he had understood a deeper law of nature, if that makes sense, that he had seen something that was fundamental to the fabric of the natural world, how parts assembled together make a complex whole, whether it is a tree, or as we'll see in a series of other images, a flood, men in combat, a machine, that all of those elements must be understood by their sort of underlying basic components. And here, he had discerned a deep sort of truth about them. I think the reason why I find this a very compelling image in relation to what Sonia is doing is that part of the reasons why Leonardo's work reflects, surviving works, reflect such a wide array of interests. They seem to pass from machines to nature, to portraits, is that he was constantly working, as one historian has described, laterally. That is to say, he was looking at something and then trying to understand what its components were, how those components might relate to another component. And in so doing, he was always taking things apart and putting them back together again, taking the parts apart, thinking of them in isolation, and then considering how they might be fit together. And so in Leonardo's much more complex paintings, what appear to be here simple studies and visual arguments of having understood basic laws would be assembled together. And that, in a sense, makes me think about what Sonia is doing in the dance, taking a fragment of something Leonardo has said, elements of his reflections on the body, on machines, stilling them for a moment, understanding them, and then sort of setting them into motion. And I think I would begin by emphasizing that that is really maybe the central feature of Leonardo's thought, to my mind, this kind of constant loop between disassembling and then reassembling. And that's where his expertise came from. The reason why I think this is important is that it helps us understand Leonardo not as a figure outside of his time. And I think there's a tendency, particularly in recent biography, to think of him as sort of the lone, isolated genius doing things that no one else was doing. But in fact, the principal kind of feature of Leonardo, if you think of him historically, is that he was using a traditional toolkit. Although he used it in extraordinary ways, the tools at his disposal were, in fact, the traditional tools of his time. And I think we have a desire to kind of think of him as modern, but I would maybe urge as a one way to reflect on Leonardo is to think of him as someone in a different time and to kind of acknowledge the sophistication of the tools available in his world. First and foremost, I would say that his toolkit was ordered around the relationship between theory and practice. I mean, I think you can see some of that being worked out, that you knew, and then you know, and you do. And there is a constant interaction between those aspects of human understanding of the world. His knowing was a borrowing of what he could access. He was not entirely lettered in Latin. One thing to understand is that coming of age, Leonardo was born in 1452. He's a provincial who moved into Florence. We find him in the records working as a painter in 1472. By 1476, he was working in the workshop of a very prominent Florentine painter, Andrea del Verrocchio, and is there that he sort of gets his chops as an artist. But he did not have access to the bookish culture of his time in an immediate way. Later on in his career, he would have relationships with mathematicians, Luca Pacioli, with humanists, Machiavelli, but he was always receiving that kind of theoretical knowledge from others who knew the Latin better than he, who knew the Greek. And so he lives at a time where there's a really interesting interaction between people who knew how to do things with their hands and people who had developed a highly sophisticated bookish culture. And he's always kind of on the edges of that, but hungry for that knowledge. And really what we see in his notebooks is that he laments his limitations in terms of accessing that kind of theoretical knowledge. His view of the world was fundamentally Aristotelian, so one thing to understand is that how Leonardo sees the cosmos is as a kind of spherical plenum. It is a ball, a sphere. It's actually a set of nine crystalline spheres that move out. He is in the realm like all humans and all matter and nature that he's interested in. He's in the sublunary realm below the moon. Everything is in motion and change there. And so his understanding is of a kind of earthly physics that is the knowledge of his time. He has a kind of relatively up-to-date but layperson's understanding of that kind of theoretical knowledge. It's also Euclidean geometry, so he would have had some knowledge of those ideas, and he clearly is a great practitioner, but again, his knowledge of these things is kind of mediated through his own limits. His approach, and I think you can see it again here, is that visual arguments were more important than words. And that, in fact, what drawings, what paintings, what any image represented is a visual representation of having understood a truth, and that a picture is more important than a drawing. We spend a lot of attention on the sort of his, you know, backwards sort of chicken scratch writing. It was meant to be a sort of something of a cipher, but really it is the proof of concept is in the drawings. And these are demonstrations, that would maybe as a kind of third fundamental point, that he saw the human intellect as kind of ordered in three fundamental ways. Fantasia, fantasy, that is the capacity to see the world and imagine and create. That principle arises from what he called intelletto, intellect, that is the kind of, you know, cognition and knowing. And the sharpest edge of that intellect is what he called ragione, reason. And he's always moving between those kinds of extremes of cognition, flights of fancy and fantasia, but also the kind of hard edge of reason, if that makes any sense. And it is kind of his marginal nature to the bookish learning that gave him the room, I would suggest to you, to kind of take that latitude in ways that perhaps others could not. Finally, I think before moving on, he had a kind of theory of nature. And that theory of nature you see, again, compressed and reflected here. First of all, is that nature had a rule universally, and that, you know, the rules apply everywhere. Second, that necessity orders nature. The word he used again and again is necessità, that nature suffers no imperfection, that all that nature does is ordered by that fundamental necessary principle. That applies to how you might build a wing to create a flying machine, how you might make a statue stand, how you get a tree right, and you understand its fundamental internal structure and its harmony. Third, that geometry is the core of all of this, that you can understand the world geometrically. And fourth, perhaps most important, is that change and dynamism are the steady state of the natural world. Let's see if we can move forward. This is not moving. Oh, there we go. We're good. So let's follow for a moment the path of change. This is not Leonardo's own work. This is done by the 16th century artist Peter Paul Rubens, but it's based likely on a sketch of a cartoon that Leonardo did in competition, actually, with Michelangelo. What it depicts is a scene from Florentine history, 1444. It depicts a battle. It's really a minor skirmish that the Florentines were never a great military power, and so they were always anxious about their own kind of immediate past. And what Leonardo was commissioned to depict here was a scene where the papal commander, as you can see over here, Piccinini, is stripping the Florentine commander is stripping the standard from the rival Florentine commander. So it's a political image. It tells us something about Leonardo as a working artist, that in fact he was rarely without a commission, and rather than someone that's always sort of hunting for a commission, he's a courtier at the orbit of constantly various courts, and his works were sort of responses often to political commissions, telling him, asking him what to draw, but again, and depict, embedded in the work, you see again the same attempt to point out that there are deeper patterns. Again, maybe to return to those words, fantasia, the flights of fancy, but underneath there's the hard edge of reason that explains how a body moves, how in fact turbulence can be represented. And I use that word turbulence because Leonardo will end my discussion here by looking at some of his images of floods that perhaps you may have familiar, and I would ask you to kind of juxtapose these together, that what he is displaying is patterns in the morass, trying to understand how very complex motion, it's made up of all sorts of different parts, can be made to look right and true to nature and necessary. This is his own original work, the sketch of that same papal commander that you see represented. It is, in the terms of Leonardo, it's the depiction of a person's, of the commander in what he called una pazzia bestialissima, a beastly rage. And it demonstrates, in fact, Leonardo's attention to the ways in which those rules, those fundamental rules about how nature, matter is arranged, also dictate the expressions of a face and the emotions of an individual, and all of those things. So it is, in fact, how he gets at the ways in which he understands human expression. We celebrate, for example, La Gioconda, known as Mona Lisa, that kind of enigmatic image of a face. I would urge you to kind of think that, in fact, what he's doing is not unlike what he's doing in the tree. He's representing his knowledge of understanding what the basic fundamental mechanisms. He knows the muscles, he knows the motions of the face, and he knows the way in which the machine expresses the emotions of the body. It's a glimpse of his times as well, and really the time is too short to spend much time talking about it, but I think it's worth simply noting that Leonardo's lifetime was an age of upheaval. He is born in 1452. The Italian city-states 2 years later declare when he's an infant clearly, a kind of temporary truce, but in Leonardo's lifetime, Italy would be torn apart by a century and a half of warfare. And Leonardo was an opportunist. He traveled, he avoided the conflicts when he could, when there were valuable commissions as a military engineer and elsewhere in the service, sometimes of the Florentines, other times in the service of the invaders, the French, and eventually the Spanish as well, and then back to the French. He was kind of, I wouldn't call him a turncoat by our standards, but he lived in a time where these expressions are, in a sense, the tone of the age. It's an age of sieges, of warfare, and it is the same age that produced, for instance, Machiavelli's own arguments that a prince must display ferocious cruelty, inumana crudeltà, in order to govern accurately. And it's a suggestion, in fact, that we might locate Leonardo in his time. So two men actually work together, and that's a separate story, but I think what's relevant is to understand that, in a sense, we can see Leonardo's own interaction with an age of war and suffering, and it's the understory of his work. Most significant, however, are the universals, I would say, that Leonardo's work aspired to get at. That everything, as I've tried to suggest, is a visual argument about deeper truths. He's practicing the argument. He's demonstrating in the picture, more than in the words, that he understands how nature worked. And his arguments take a number of specific shapes. One, and I'll just list them and then we'll go through some images that show them, is that knowledge is embodied in the body. That there isn't knowledge outside of sensory experience, but that knowledge, you can see its embodiment in the body. Second, that there is underlying structure that in fact can be discerned, and that the ingegno, that is the word the Italians use to describe the whole complex of someone's intelligence, we later kind of abstracted as genius, but it really means a kind of set of faculties and abilities that include instinct, they include reason, they include fantasy and imagination, all of that that you, if you understand the structure of living things, that you can replicate them in machines and make a second nature. And his arguments and his work express that conviction. Third, that the body doesn't exist outside of its relationship to the environment, but that it is in relation, in proportion, and in harmony with space around it. We'll look at the Vitruvian Man in a second, but to understand that he's always thinking about how bodies move in space, how spaces shape bodies, and he draws that insight first from nature and thinks about how it is then expressed in built space. Even though he's not known as an architect in the large sense, he interacts with and he lives in an age of great architecture, and he thinks of bodies in relationship to machines inside a war machine, for instance. I'm thinking of your dance. That's what Leonardo's working through when he designs those projects. Finally, that all the parts relate to the whole, and that you don't understand a whole without understanding each and every part and how they work together. So embodied knowledge. I'll pause on each of these moments, sort of ideas for a moment. This is perhaps a rather famous sketch of, this is in the Windsor Castle collection, of Leonardo working through an attempt to understand what sensory experience is like. It's his demonstration that he thinks he understands the origin of our mental faculties. And what he was representing, in fact, see if I can point here, is the movement of of sensory experience. Does this have a, no, this does not have a point.
In the middle.
Middle, thank you. Disappears on.
Well, there it is.
Is it on the screen? That's sort of lost, I can point. You can see the series of three vessels going back into the brain. It's essentially an argument about how sensory experience becomes cognition, if that makes any sense. So it is in fact received by the eye. It is stored in an initial in sort of physical vessel. So what's crucial to kind of get at is that he's trying to understand how the parts create consciousness, if that makes any sense, how there is an emergent property from all of the different components that sensory experience is stored in what he called the sensus communis. Then it is passed to that next middle vessel, the imprensiva. This is where it is in fact assembled into what we would think of as cognition. This is where, again, fantasia, intelletto, ragione, all the elements that make knowledge. And behind is the last vessel, which stores memory. And it is an attempt to understand how sort of sensory experience becomes knowledge. What you will then sort of will follow is to think about how the conduits of that back out the body into the world, how they're expressed through the machinery of the body into humans creating what he called seconda natura, nature, second nature, nature yet again, recreated from what nature has done to the mind and to the body. Does that make sense? Mind, that knowledge is in the body. He explained, for instance, that sciences are in vain and full of errors if they're not born of experience, mother of all certainty, and not tested by experience. That is to say, they do not, as their origin, have the middle or pass through any of the five senses. There is no knowing without seeing. And I think that maybe helps you understand why showing in a picture is so important. That seeing is the most important of the five senses. And therefore, it is, I think, continuous with that idea to argue that a visual argument is the demonstration of truth. It matters more than what you say in your words. The body as a machine. These are anatomical studies of the male shoulder. There is often, I think, an initial impression that Leonardo is showing you exactly what the body looked like. He's not. He's making an argument. He's simplifying. What he's doing here, for instance, is stripping and thinning the muscles down so that he can make an argument about the lines of force that, in fact, control motion of the body. What he's trying to show you is that he understands the physics of the body. He understands how the contraction, doesn't know, you know, the chemical processes going on in muscles, but he understands that muscles contract. He knows that tendons are the pulleys. What he's trying to show you here by pulling things away is that he understands the motion of the body, and again, how he can show this in a picture in ways that his words cannot. His texts are suggestions for corrections, notes to self. This is the argument and the illustration. And you might, in fact, follow that line to the wing, to the flying machine. That, in fact, translating the motion of the muscles, understanding how the shoulder works, is the only way you design the wing in following the principles of nature and necessity. Just to pause a moment on the wing, there's a lot of speculation about how good are Leonardo's flying machines? Would any of his elaborate contraptions have worked? In two instances where they've been tested, in one case, his ballista, his large, enormous crossbow bolt, when they tried to draw it back and built it to scale, it cracked and it tore apart. But as, in fact, historians have pointed out, there is no one who has nearly the woodworking ability of the people in Leonardo's time. And so a dimension of Leonardo's world is a knowledge of materials, metals, but I would actually emphasize wood, that just is simply lost. Our inability to recreate Leonardo's machines may be limitations in Leonardo's machines, but they also may be limitations in our ability to actually build them in the ways that craftsmen would have been able to. To cite the wing, this has actually been, there's an Austrian attempt at this. I tried to find a YouTube of it, but a video of it, but I couldn't. But there's reported this has actually been, part of the wings have been used to simulate a fairly decent glider. So I think it's rather than sort of getting lost on whether his machines work or not, it's important to understand that we tend to see these as sort of throwaway ideas, but Leonardo is working consistently. And he's always distracted in his work. I think this is long known. But his intentions are true to everything he does. These aren't, he's trying to get it right. Finally, the hand. That might bring us, we followed the body in some ways down, if that makes any sense, from the head to the shoulder to the hand. He's doing the same things. He's simplifying, he's pulling apart, he's showing the tendons. He's trying to understand the mechanisms of the hand. Deeply interested, of course, in the hand, like artists of his generation. Michelangelo, famous, painted in the School of Athens, the image of the classical philosopher Heraclitus, leaning on a piece of marble, thinking, and Michelangelo showed the kind of interaction between the mind and the hand. Something similar is going on here, that the hand is where humans express their capacity to transform their knowledge of nature into a new kind of second nature, to build and to make and to follow the rules of necessity in the design of human things and human spaces and objects. This is, of course, you know, widely, you've likely seen this, the widely known demonstration of the geometrical design of the human body. Leonardo had some access to a work on architecture from a generation preceding him. This was a humanist by the name of Leon Battista Alberti, had written a work called De Pictura, on painting, which was a riff on a Roman work by the Roman author Vitruvius on architecture, which dates from the first century. So what was happening in Leonardo's world is that he lived in a culture that was retrieving the theoretical knowledge of the ancients, bringing it back to life. Leonardo is here interacting with that theoretical knowledge and is making an argument, in fact, for the ways in which you can understand and must understand by necessity the proportions of the body on the basis of geometrical principles, that the square and the circle here represented can all be a way to abstract the universal proportions of the human body that apply to painting, that apply to making a machine that might work to fly, that applies to understanding how you might put 20 infantrymen inside a machine and make that machine work, to understand the ratio of the limbs to the body. All of those things are built in. And fundamentally, an interest in stillness, the body abstracted in a kind of posture that is fairly rare for a human who's doing anything useful or productive. And you might think back of what humans really look like when they're moving. In the image of the Battle of Ain Gedi, that's what bodies look like, but you don't get at that without understanding their proportions accurately. You set them into motions, you stop, you still it, and then you run the loop, and you move it into motion. And interested in their varieties of that motion. This is his famous sketch of a Florentine conspirator who in 1478 had tried to assassinate Lorenzo de' Medici, had managed to kill his brother Giuliano, had fled into the Ottoman Empire. The Florentines had sent spies and agents, had grabbed him, brought him back, and still dressed as an Ottoman Turk, they had executed it and sort of finished what had been the bloody vendetta of the Medici regime for that Leonardo serves to sort of finish the, you know, silence the coup once and for all. Leonardo is present, studying, of course, again, what the appearance of a body is in death. And the written text here, again, is that same interaction. It notes the color of the clothing, but it is really meaningless without the attention and the argument that the image portrays about how to portray, in this case, a hanged conspirator. Finally, maybe something that assembles it all together, one of his wilder sketches. This is the deluge. It's an extraordinary event that's happening, actually. It's a deluge, and at the same time, the mountain has collapsed. So it's a kind of, apocalyptic scene. And I think it's a good example of his broader kind of perspicacity and view of the natural world, that Leonardo spent a lot of time outside. He didn't live in intensely sort of simply human environments, but he was in fact often in the field. We know, for instance, that he had a temporary, little documented project with the Florentine Chancellor Machiavelli to try to divert the flow of the Arno River so that Florence could strangle the city on the Mediterranean, Pisa, without a river and redirect. It's a crazy cockamamie project. It never works, like many of Machiavelli things that he tried to do in the real world, just like Leonardo. But they do work kind of together, and he's really interested later in his life with the flows of water, particularly with the problem of turbulence, which seems to be the kind of greatest expression of what he's trying to understand. It's like the most complex phenomenon because, in fact, it compresses. It has all of those different parts. He's trying to answer the hardest kinds of questions once he's broken all of the pieces apart. And what he's grappling with, and I'll end with here, is not just motion and many different components working together to create an event, but he's actually also trying to think about these things across time. And that's maybe one last dimension of, again, the ways in which Leonardo was traditional in his world. His time span is a couple thousand years. Perhaps he had read Aristotle closely enough to have doubts. Aristotle actually suggested that the world was eternal. We don't really know, but he's probing that question. And he's trying to understand, for instance, here, I'll end with a couple of lines. You might consider this, since things are far more ancient than letters, it is not to be wondered at if in our days no record exists of how these seas covered so many countries, and if, moreover, such a record ever existed, the wars, the conflagrations, the deluges of the waters, the changes of languages and laws have consumed every vestige of the past. So we see a glimpse of Leonardo, perhaps the proto-geologist, interested in what the ways in which what remains tells us about a world that has been lost. He went on to write, in particular, that he was interested in shells and fossils in particular. He, in one of his notes, notebooks, he writes, "In this work of yours, you have to prove that the shells, you have to first prove that the shells at a height of 1,000 braccia were not carried there by the deluge." And again, the painting is a visual argument. He's trying to understand actually how the earth has changed over time. And this leads him to some extraordinary conclusions, and I'll end with these. The microcosmos and the macrocosmos, the parts and the whole, the little and the big, design and necessity governing all of them, and thinking about them not just in the present, but over the expanse of time. The creature that resides within the shell, so he's thinking about fossils, but he's thinking about living things at the same time. Constructs his dwelling with joints and seams and roofing and various other parts, just as man does in the house where he dwells. And this creature expands the house and roof gradually as its body increases, since it is attached to the side of these shells, necessity. Therefore, the brightness and smoothness of these shells on the inner side is somewhat dulled at the point where they are attached to the creature that dwells there, and its hollow is roughened in order to receive the knitting together of the muscles by means of which the creature draws in when it wishes to shut itself up within its house. It gives you a glimpse of someone who's looking at things infinitely small, all of their little parts, trying to understand how it works. Just as a side note, this is exactly like Aristotle. Whether he's learned from books that he could barely read, this is certainly his practice. How do you explain to me, now think about how it expands out, how do you explain to me the fact that the shingle being all stuck together, he's referring to a rock in which he's finding fossils, all stuck together and lying in layers at different altitudes in the high mountains? The question that had long bothered people, why are there fossils in the mountains? Was it the flood that did this? If the deluge had carried the shells for distances of 300 or 400 miles from the sea, it would have carried them mixed up with various natural objects all heaped together. But even at such distances from the sea, we see the oysters all together, and also all the shellfish and the cuttlefish and all the other shells which congregate together, found altogether dead. And the solitary shells are found apart from one another as we see them every day on the seashores. So I might end with that. Leonardo in the mountains, looking at fossils and seeing them all arranged as they would have been in an ancient seabed. And you might go back an image to the image of a flood and his understanding of turbulence and the forces that would have scattered all of that stuff all over the place. And as he looks at all those, he understands, in fact, a deep past, that he's looking at a world that had existed before. He connected that with what appear to be his observations of the sea floor. Did he look in underwater? We don't know, but it is a powerful suggestion, again, that what he was drawing from was, in fact, visual experience, seeing combined with touching and holding, but again and again, it is what he's able to pull apart, see, represent in drawing, and then run the loop again, wield it, take it in the mountains, and understand what he's seen. And I'll end there.
So now I have to. So I'm going to be brief because I really want to hear the panelists, but I could actually spend another hour talking about what I put into the dance. So I do want to show you an excerpt, but I'm going to show you the beginning of the dance, which is called Artist Studio. What I was fascinated with Da Vinci's notebooks is not just the drawings, and if you, when you look at them and you'll see that on you know, one side is in the Italian and on the other side is the English translation, and there are, you know, there are two volumes, and you know, there's sections. The way they put the books together is so that we, in this, you know, time period, can understand it, as opposed to it being, you know, chronological, the way Da Vinci might have, you know, thought of this and then that and then that, but so we can understand them. So for example, in the whole section on ecclesiastical architecture, there's just these, you know, gorgeous drawings of, you know, shapes and octagons and this and that and put together, and so you're looking at the floor patterns and you're looking at what's going to be the steeple, and then he has, you know, the arches, and then he's philosophizing about if you put out, you know, the not just the mathematics that go behind the arch and how they're supporting, but, you know, okay, if you know, they're two parts of a circle and they support each other, but if they're separate, they're weak. You know, so all of that inside the notebooks, I took my dancers through to create the dance, and the dance is 75 minutes, at least 75 minutes long, and I'm actually adding on to it. So what I'm going to show you is the beginning, and it's called Artist Studio. And one of the tasks I gave my dancers is that they had to sculpt each other, but they had to discover. So as dancers, we're trained how to move our bodies and how to pick up and throw and dance and, you know, carry and all that. So, you know, what was going to be interesting about this particular task was not knowing, you're having to say you do not know. You do not know that I'm going to pick up this hand and it's going to do this on that person. Because the other dancer had to be inside their head going, okay, I'm going to give a lot of resistance or not much resistance, you know, gravity and, you know, are you made of clay? Are you made of wood? Or, you know, are you going to have a response? And the interesting thing is, I mean, even in Da Vinci's notebooks, he will talk about resistance and gravity and all of that. It's all in there. So we get to play with that and make something. So I want you to, you know, I'm just going to show you about 4 minutes, because then we're going to take a little break and go to our panelists. So I have to just put it up. I'm not going to say anything more. Sorry.
Okay.
Come la chiarezza dell'aria nasce dall'acqua che in quella si è risoluta e fattasi di insensibili granito, i quali, preso il lume del sole dell'opposita parte, rendono la chiarezza che in essa l'aria si dimostra, e l'azzurro che in quella apparisce nasce dalle tenebre che dopo essa aria si nasconde.
Thank you.
and help yourself to beverages or whatever, and then we'll get going.